There is something that we as a country are failing to confront in anything like a responsible way, and which is confronting us and every other nation in the world, and will confront us and our children and our grandchildren almost for certain. For, you know, as long as we're still alive, this is going to be an issue. And I don't want us to have to be ashamed at our failure to confront it. And I'm talking about climate change. And I know that there are a lot of people, particularly people who watch Fox News and other sources of what is laughingly called information from that side, who believe that they know certain things, that they believe that they know that there is no scientific consensus, for example. Well, the fact is, it was a study conducted by very reputable people and published in the proceedings of the American Academy of National Academy of Sciences, very prestigious, that showed that 97% of the top scientists in the field are agreed upon certain basic points. We've got global warming, human activity is germane to it, and the possible consequences are considerable to the magnitude that we really, to be responsible citizens of this planet and responsible to our children and grandchildren, need to do something about it. 97%, it's not unanimity. You don't get unanimity about much of anything, but 97% is close enough. So they think that that there's not a scientific consensus because people who lie to them are telling them there's not a scientific consensus. They think that that scandal, I put that in quotation marks, having to do with the emails, shows that the science has been corrupted. It's simply not true. There have been investigations done by the National Science Foundation, by the Royal Society in England, and various other reputable bodies, and said that nothing that was shown in this email scandal had reflected at all on the quality of the science. There are people who have been told that the way science works, you got that we have essentially a conspiracy of scientists from all over the world who are drumming up this hoax in order to frighten people so they get more research grants. That isn't the world as it operates. I mean, we definitely need to be able to shut the liars out of our public discourse. We have so much at stake that if liars are allowed to persuade large chunks of the American people of things that are simply flat out not true, we are crippled as a society. And that is bad enough when it comes to things like reforming our healthcare system so we don't pay twice as much for a system that doesn't work as well as what some other people have. It's bad enough to deal with our financial system so that we don't leave ourselves with this too big to fail so that we're still on the hook if these guys take risks they shouldn't take and we've dismantled something which made us immune to that from the time of Franklin Delano Roosevelt until the last decade or so. But we have a crisis that faces us where we could conceivably lose the ability to feed ourselves in the course of the coming decades. We could lose half of Florida underwater. The people who need to be serious about this sort of thing for financial reasons, like the insurance companies, they already are serious. The United States military and the Pentagon treats it as a major national security threat. They did their own study. The people who need to know. But there are some people, and I'm talking about a vast industry of the richest corporations in the world, that are willing to spend lots of money to keep us addicted to the same ways. We don't have to hurt ourselves. We just have to become responsible and have to start doing some of the kinds of things that we do in a national emergency. My parents, during World War II, they got vegetables in a garden. It was called a victory garden. They knew that there were certain kinds of materials that the Americans were not going to be consuming as wantonly because the troops needed it. They didn't suffer over it. They had a common cause. We now must make common cause to deal with this crisis, not to cripple our economy, but to direct it to grow in certain ways so that we develop other alternative energy sources, so that we, as in a country, become a leader in this direction and don't leave it to the Chinese to be selling everybody the technologies that people are going to rely on, whether we want to or not. So this is maybe not a foreign policy question, but right now, the United States has moved from where we were in the 1970s, which was as a leader among civilized societies in terms of confronting the impact, that the humanity has on this planet. Where there are now 7 billions of us. We are much richer than we were a century ago, or even a few centuries ago, and people in China and India, more than 1 billion in each country, have rising standards of living. We are using technologies that didn't exist long ago. It shouldn't be a surprise to us that compared to the 2 centuries ago when our Constitution was written, we have to make some adjustments because we are such a bigger bull in this China shop. And if we are going to get, if we are going to be truly conservative, that means that we do not indulge ourselves at the expense of the ability of future generations to live decently themselves. And that is a moral imperative. If we continue to do what the Republican Party is insisting that we do, which is to pretend that this problem isn't there, future generations will have difficulty forgiving us. And I don't want us to be in that position.